Betty.
Good morning.
We have both had our vaccines, both of them.
Oh, good.
Have we?
Yeah, we've got both of them.
We've got both of them.
Is that a good feeling?
Once apart.
Joan and I get our second shot on March 11th.
March 12th. Kim and I are both in the next group, but who knows when that will start.
I thought it was going to start in March.
Yeah, it's supposed to.
Supposed to be tomorrow, but.
But they don't have any sign-up set up for it yet.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Don't teacher priority?
Yeah.
Teachers are.
Teacher and library for me.
Morning. I think we'll get started with worship here. We'll start with some announcements. I'm your moderator today, Rick Locken. Our liturgist will be Jim Showalter. Pastor Julie will be available after worship from 11:30 to 12:30 to receive your offerings and food pantry donations. Prayer shawls and prayer patches are available for pickup. Our family Lent kits are available for pickup anytime. They are located in the covered bin by the front doors. It is not too late to join us for our Lenten study. The first class was recorded. Please direct any questions to Nikki Moore. We are ordering giving envelopes for 2022. We are looking at cutting cost and only ordering for those who want envelopes. Please fill out your name in the sign up through Redeemer Reminders or call the church office. That is all the announcements for this morning.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Redeemer United Church of Christ, located in Sussex, Wisconsin. I am Jim Showalter, your liturgist for today. Please take a minute to fill out the Who's Where in the Chair survey located in the Zoom chat or in the Facebook comments section. To do this, simply copy and paste the link from the chat box into your internet browser and complete the questions. This will help us connect with those of you who are here today. We are a church spiritually alive and growing, radically inclusive and engaged in our communities. Our pastor is the Reverend Julie Eklund, and today we are celebrating the second Sunday in Lent. Our welcoming music today is provided by Dan Stolper and Mary Doparella. So please enjoy our welcoming music.
El Shaddai, El Elyon, O Adonai, age to age you're still the same, by the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai. Of you. El Shaddai, El Elyon, O Adonai, age to age, you're still the same, by the power of the name, El Shaddai, El Shaddai, Echakon, Adonai, I will praise you till I die.
Thank you, Dan and Mary, that was beautiful. Please join me now in our call to worship. Walk before me and be blameless, and I shall make my covenant between me and you. Quite openly, we've measured that distance. Quite openly, we didn't want to be closer. Quite openly, we've distanced ourselves. Quite openly, we didn't want to be closer. Quite openly, we are not blameless. Quite openly, we are here. We are here to open ourselves to our in-between God. Now please join me in singing our gathering song, Be Now My Vision.
You and you. treasure, may we never part.
Please join me in the prayer of invitation. As in days of old, Creator God, we walk before you seeking a covenant between us. We accept our responsibility as ancestors of many. We will lead and guide in your name. We accept your blessings and will establish our everlasting covenant. May we go forth declaring the good news to our offspring. Amen.
Time, during this time of Lent, we set aside time to confess and repent. For though we gather with the intentions of being people of God, we still fall short of perfect love for Christ and one another. May we confess together. We are quite open about our successes. We feel free to boast when we have done well, but we are not quite so open when things have gone wrong. We do not praise God anyway. Instead, we recognize the distance between me and you, between you and God and me. Let's be quite open about it as we open ourselves to our living God in silence. Amen. Please hear these words of assurance. You can look behind. You can search ahead. God will meet you in between. God promises to always be right there. God is between here and there, between me and you, between us and our neighbor. Amen. We have an anniversary this week, Carl and Joan C. Congratulations on 56 years of marriage. Woohoo, is right. We also have some birthdays to celebrate. Renee C., Don H., Angie W., Tammy S., Mike S., and Easton D. Happy birthday. We wish you many, many blessings.
even though the words didn't make it in PowerPoint, we'll still do it. So hopefully you'll remember most of the words.
What a glad day, today's your birthday. All the common greetings we say. What a glad day, today's your birthday. May God's blessings upon you stay. We are friends, join with you in celebrating this day. What a glad day, today's your birthday. May God's blessings upon you stay. May God's blessings upon you stay.
All right, it's time for a child in all of us. Can my friends come closer to their screens?
Hi.
Hi. All right. Hi. I'm looking for all my friends. I see the Steffens, and I'm pretty sure I heard the Eckerts. Hi.
Yes. Hi.
All right. Hi. Today we're going to talk about names. Does anyone know the story of why your parents named you the name that they did and what your name means?
I forgot, but my mom did tell me.
Okay. All right. What about you, Sierra? Do you remember or do you know?
Sierra Dell.
That's after your great. After your great aunt. Yeah, an aunt.
Your name after your great aunt?
Yeah.
Awesome. What about Casey and Lexi? Do you know why you were named what you were named?
Nope. No.
No? No? Okay, well, I kind of guessed who might be on as friends today, so I looked up what your names mean. Now, I don't know why your parents named you them, but Braden is an English last name. It meant someone from Braden or someone who lives near a broad valley. Can also mean broad, brave, or wise. Sierra is a Spanish word for saw or mountain range. And it kind of, it means strength and groundedness. Casey is derived from English Gaelic, word that I can't pronounce, Cathasaig, C-A-T-H-A-S-A-I-G-H. And it means vigilant or watchful. And Lexi is interpreted from the Greek alexin, which means to defend. So now you know what your names mean. My name, Julie, means youthful. Do you think I look youthful?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you. So today we're talking about names because God comes to a man and a woman named Abram and Sarai, and he wants to make a new covenant with them, a new relationship, and he changes their names to Abraham and Sarah. Would that be weird if God came to you and said, I'm going to change your name?
Yeah.
I just read that in the Bible.
Yeah. You did. What did you think when you read that? Did you think that was crazy?
Yeah.
Yeah. What we learned today is that God he wanted to renew the covenant. And so God came and said that we're going to renew our relationship so it goes on for generations after generations after generations. And I'm going to tweak your name in honor of this new covenant, this new relationship that all people are going to share now, everybody. Did you know that? Oh. So just remember that we are all a part of this covenant from generations to generations. All right? Can you help me pray?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you. Thank you for Sarah and Abraham.
Thank you for Sarah and Abraham.
Thank you for Sarah and Abraham.
Thank you for our names.
Thank you for our names.
And claiming us as your own.
And claiming us as your own.
Amen.
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 Thank you so much.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Don't forget to ask your parents why they named you the name they did.
Our scripture lesson this morning is from Genesis 17, verses 1 through 7 and 15 through 16. When Abram was 99 years old, Yahweh appeared and said, "I am the Blessed One. Walk in my presence and be blameless. I will make a covenant between you and me, and I will increase your numbers exceedingly." Abram fell on his face before God, and God said to him, "This is my covenant with you. You will be the ancestor of many nations. You are no longer to be called Abram, respected parent, but Abraham, progenitor of a multitude, for you are the progenitor of a multitude of nations." "I will make you most fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and rulers will spring from you. I will establish my covenant as an everlasting covenant between me and you, and your descendants after you for generations to come. I will be your God and the God of your descendants after you." God continued, "As for Sarai, her name will now be Sarah, noble woman. I will bless her and I will give you a child by her. I will bless her and she will become nations. Rulers of peoples will come from her." These are the words of our still speaking God.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we come seeking a new name. May we be open to transformation, definition, and a closer relationship with you. And may the meditation of our hearts and the words upon my lips be acceptable to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. In 1978, my older sister, Sarah, was 9 years old and the baby of 4 children. She desperately wanted a younger sibling to love and take care of, and a sibling that would relieve her of her title, baby. Much to her disappointment, our parents told Sarah that they were too old and not planning on any more children. Well, that didn't stop my sister Sarah from praying to God for intervention. She prayed and prayed for a little sister. In 1980, I was born. My parents were stunned, my sister happy, and the decision of what to name me was on the table. Because they believed that I was Sarah's child, she did pray for me after all, they gave her the task of selecting my name. Sarah was in search of a J name because she didn't want our mom to be left out. You see, my dad's name was Ben, and my brother's names are Brad and Brian, and the girls are Sandy and Sarah. Our mom, Joyce, was a J all by herself. At Sarah's school, there was a set of twins named Julie and Jennifer. Sarah liked the name Julie, and her classmate named Julie was always nice to her. And so she decided that I should become a Julie too. The name Julie is from the Latin name Julia, which means youthful, soft-haired, beautiful, or vivacious. I certainly would define myself as a youthful person, and so I believe my name fits appropriately. Growing up, the popular names in class were Jennifer, Megan, and Jessica. Julie wasn't really a popular name. There was only one other Julie that I encountered my entire time in school. As I was thinking about names, I decided to glance at our Redeemer members and look at popular names here. We have several Ricks, Jims, Nancys, Bobs, Sues, Georges. Names have meaning and purpose. Do you know the story behind your name and what your name means? One of the authors and public speakers that I've been learning about recently is a Black woman named Austin Channing Brown. She is friends with Brené Brown, and that is how I have come to find out about her. Austin has a story behind her name. In an interview with Kelly Brown Douglas on Courageous and Just, Conversations on Faith in Challenging Times, Kelly Brown Douglas asks Austin, when was it that she became aware of her Blackness and what did it mean to her? She said that there were two incidents that she recalls clearly. The first was the first time she was called the N-word. The second is when she found out about her name. Austin tells of her story of being at the public library. She walked up to the librarian to check out her books by herself and handed the librarian her library card. The librarian asked her, "Is this your library card?" She replied, "I'm pretty sure." The librarian says, "This card says Austin." "Oh yes, that's my card," she said. And then she got upset and went over to her mother and asked, "Why did you choose Austin as my name?" Her mom sat her down and said, "Austin, one day you are going to have to apply for jobs. And we knew that if your job application said Austin, people would assume that you are a white man. And we just needed to make sure that you got an interview." The Rev. Dr. Cheryl A. Lindsay, Sermon Seeds writer and editor, wrote this week in Sermon Seeds, quote, "Names have meaning. They serve as identifiers of individuals. They also reflect relationships and familiar connections. Names are given to us reflecting cultural norms and parental preferences. We associate our names with who we are, but they are often given in hope of who we might become. Many cultures conduct naming ceremonies that reflect the significance of the name for not only the person, but the community. Names have meaning," end quote. In listening to Austin's story, I cannot imagine being given a name to protect me from the harsh realities of the country we live in. Names have meaning. I left behind my maiden name, Greenwalt, in 2002. The tradition in Western culture for brides to take the names of their groom signifies a leaving of one family and entering into another. To be honest, 18 years ago when I got married, I never thought about whether or not I'd change my name. It was just something that I assumed I was supposed to do. But being in Eklund for 18 years now, I've discovered something. It is not my name. I've been asked, Eklund, are you related to so-and-so? Well, I don't know. It's not my name. I'd have to ask my in-laws. Does the covenant exchange of vows and rings also apply to our names? Does a name change signify something about a relationship? Our scripture reading today from the book of Genesis focuses on names, specifically the renaming of Sarai and Abram. Sarah and Abraham have been married for quite some time. And now God has come to create a new covenant with them. God wants to create a relationship with them that includes a promise that the kin that comes generation after generation with them. God says, I will make a covenant between you and me, and I will increase your numbers exceedingly. And Abram fell on his face before God, and God said to him, this is my covenant with you. You will be the ancestor of many nations. Now, God has had a covenant with Abram before, but this time, God is coming to adjust the covenant. Where we pick up today is after Abram tried to protect himself by denying his marital relationship to Sarai. He does it in Egypt with Pharaoh and in Gerar with its king by pretending that she is his sister rather than his wife. This is also after Sarai endorses a temporary arrangement with Hagar. These situations put their covenantal relationship to the test, and they had to repair and restore the relationship as a married couple. Abram and Sarai took actions in their marriage that disrupted the relationship with one another and with God, but their covenant was not broken. Only in need of repair. So God wants to readjust the covenant this time because things were not going so well. The Rev. Dr. Cheryl A. Lindsay wrote, quote, in this covenant declaration, names change, but not completely. These are more shifts than revolutions. Abram shifts from being a High Father to Abram, father of multitude or many nations. Sarai shifts from being my princess to Sarah, princess. Her identity moves from her association with someone else to her own. She is her own story, and God treats her independently, if interdependently, from Abram. The interdependent promise, I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her, is followed by the independent promise, I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of people shall come from her. God makes a covenant with Sarai and marks it with a new name that reflects her identity, shifting from belonging to someone else to having a stature that is all hers. She is a princess. She will raise nations and kings. She is blessed by God for herself, for God's purposes, and for the generations that will come from her. End quote. So God renames Sarai. God also said to Abraham, as for Sarai, her name will now be Sarah. Our version says, noble woman. I will bless her and I will give you a child by her. I will bless her and she will become nations. Rulers of peoples will come from her. God said she is not solely dependent on Abram for her identity. She is a beloved child of God in her own right. Her connection with Abram is in the covenant they make with one another. And she has a covenantal relationship with God. Call her Sarah. This covenantal relationship they have with God extends for generations after them. What we promise to God and with others affects our communities and those around us. How we value our relationship with God, with our significant others, with our children, all have an impact on the communities in which we live. The Rev. Dr. Cheryl A. Lindsay wrote, quote, "That's what covenant does. From generation to generation, it allows us to identify with those before us and future generations. We can consider how our actions responding to the pandemic, climate, immigration, social inequities, and economic disparities, among other conditions we face communally, will impact a people yet unborn." Sarah reminds us that although covenants may be made with individuals, they are essentially made for communities. God's covenant with Abram could not work without God's covenant with Sarai. God's covenant with Sarah and Abraham could not be fulfilled without the covenant extending from generation to generation. Again, to make it explicit, God clarifies, "I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you." End quote. So names matter. The names we claim matters. So if we claim to be Christian or followers of Christ, are we living up to our covenant with Christ? If we claim the name Redeemer, United Church of Christ, are we maintaining and or adjusting our covenant as people of Christ? Names have meaning, names have power. What would God name us? This renaming of Sarah and Abraham was an adjustment of God's covenant, not just with Abraham and Sarah, but with all generations after, with all of us. We are all connected by this covenant. We are all bound together in our collective humanity and relationship with our Creator. When things seem broken, we must repair and restore our covenant with one another. We must ensure that each person is their whole self, an individual in this covenant with God, and fully accepted in this generational covenant. I think we can safely say that our covenant with each other in this country is in desperate need of repair and restoration. Our relationship with God and with Jesus Christ calls us towards our relationship with others for generations. We honor this story of Sarah and Abraham when we acknowledge their names as our names. When we uphold our covenantal relationship with God and all others, may we do the work to claim God's promise over us from generation to generation. Amen.
Wait, 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 wait.
No, I'm going to please join us in singing our song of reflection. We are dancing Sarah's circle.
One note about the PowerPoint. The first line, we are dancing Sarah's circle, actually gets repeated three times, and then the last line.
Our prayer person of the week is Bonnie Seidlitz. Please include Bonnie in your prayer sometime this week. Drop her a personal note or give Bonnie a call to let her know you indeed remembered her in your prayers. Contact information will be available in Redeemer Reminders. Our prayers this week. Oops, gotta get my sheet in the right spot. George Everett is asking for prayers for the Pershawn family as they mourn the death of Roland. Jean Farrow asks us to include Bonnie, who is the mother of her dear friend, Marianne Baker. Bonnie is 77 and going through chemo treatment for breast cancer. Also prayers for safe travel for Marianne as she returns later this week from her mom's home in Alabama. The Rockies ask us to pray the joy for science for COVID vaccines and concerns for those having rough reactions to them. Prayers also for Michelle's sister Terry in North Dakota having surgery in Fargo tomorrow. From Lori Gersandi, asking for prayers for the family of Ralphie. She passed away on Thursday at the age of 19. I was her nanny for 2 years. Dave Swan says, thanks for the gradual snow melt. From Rachel Showalter, a prayer of thanksgiving on behalf of myself and my peers in healthcare. 1 year ago this week, we had our first COVID positive patient admitted. We are still here. My team is intact and things are improving. Hallelujah. From Sue Young, prayers for a safe journey as Cy and her begin a road trip to Mississippi and New Orleans. And a note from Don McCumber. Yesterday is past and gone. Yesterday is past and gone. Tomorrow may never be mine. I pray God to show me through this day and appreciate what I have been given all my life, and most of all, love for each other. These are the prayers of the people of Redeemer.
May we now enter a time of prayer and meditation. God of wilderness and water, your Son was baptized and tempted as we are. Guide us through this season that we may not avoid struggle, but instead open ourselves to blessing through the cleansing depths of repentance and the heaven-rending words of the Spirit. We give thanks for our many blessings this day. We give thanks for Bonnie Seidlitz and the many ways she blesses others. May she remember that she is named in the covenant promise with God. We are blessed by the many generous people of our congregation who dedicate their time, their gifts, and their funds to carry on the mission and vision of the church. We are blessed with outstanding music and talented voices. We are also blessed by the many people that contribute to the life of Redeemer, our staff, our leaders for our Lent class, those who participate in the offerings of the church from our community. We give thanks for gradual snowmelt, for the science of the vaccine, for Rachel's healthcare team and the improvements from 1 year ago, for appreciation of life and love. We are blessed by you, Don. God of the covenant, you call us to be fruitful servants within creation and to offer our lives as the foundation of your realm. We lay before you the desires of our hearts, that we may be transformed by their fulfillment. We lift up all of humanity this day as people that we are in covenant with. May all people work together to honor and respect one another, to be people of abundant grace, and encourage each other to be fully human in our covenant with our Creator. May the people elected to serve honor the commitment to relationship with all humanity as part of generation to generation. May all those that find themselves struggling with something in their life be made whole through your presence and your love. May we all act justly to repair and restore our broken world. This day we lift up all those that are struggling with their health, all those that are having reactions from COVID, Terry and Bonnie. May they find healing through the relationship with you. May those that care for them find your guidance and wisdom. And may their families be guided by your strength and mercy. We lift up all those that mourn this day. Today we lift up the family of Roland Pershan, the family of Ralphie. May your covenant promise bring them peace and comfort as they grieve. We lift up all those that need to travel. We lift up Cy and Sue and Mary Ann. May your protection surround them. God of Sarah and Abraham, long ago you embraced your people in covenant and promised them your blessing. Strengthen us in faith that with your disciples of every age, we may proclaim your deliverance in Jesus Christ to generations yet unborn. Hear our voice, be heard as one. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Without talking back, without asking questions, let us move into God's love. Let us go in between with God to offer our gifts. Let us give God our thanks in our tithes and offerings. In recognition of all the many programs and events that we are able to offer as a church, we want to highlight the generosity of time, talent, and generous financial contributions of our members that make it all possible. This week, we want to lift up Mary Olson for her work on the mission team, as well as other ways she dedicates her time to caring for our congregation and community. She is passing the torch on to the next leader. Thank you, Mary, for all you do. Today's Gold Can is Healing Hearts of Waukesha County. Healing Hearts is a community-based organization whose mission is to serve and support grieving children and their families. You can contribute in many ways. Via PayPal, Vanco, and Tidely at RedeemerUCC.org. You can mail your offering to the church. You may also drop it in the mailbox at the church. Now please join in singing our departing song, Step by Step.
Oh God.
step you'll lead me in, and I will follow you all of my days. And step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days.
As you go forth this day, go forth claiming the names of Sarah and Abraham, claiming the covenant with you and with God. Go forth showing that covenant that we all belong to as God's beloved. Amen. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Rick. You did a great job for your first time. Woo!
You did a
nice, Rick. Job.
Thank you, Jim and Kyla.
Bye.
Bye.